We are into the fifth chapter of 1 John, and we will continue to study. Today, the verses chosen to cover are verses 4 and 5. Two verses, namely verses 4 and 5, we did at the end of our last study from this chapter briefly meditated on these two verses, but we will do further today to dig deeper into the words of God in these two verses. If you are ready, 1 John chapter 5 verses 4 and 5, we shall read together. Read. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world? But he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God. Now, overcoming the world is the main theme of these two verses. You can see two times in these two verses that phrase, overcoming the world, or overcometh the world, appears. So that is the main theme, isn't it? Otherwise it wouldn't be mentioned. In fact, two times in verse 4 and one time in verse 5, that makes it three times, overcometh the world. Every true child of God is created in the Lord Jesus Christ to be a victor, even a conqueror of this world. Tremendous, isn't it? No Christian is to be a loser. We are not called to live a pathetic, miserable, defeated life. Our Lord has greater agendas for us. Everyone who trusts the Lord Jesus through the Holy Spirit and through the Word of God is created to enjoy great victory. Well, the reason why we have to have victory, because we have a very powerful enemy who have organized a great team of evil forces to work against us. And so we have to understand that we are in battle. We are in very severe, fierce battle. At no time we are in a homeland where nobody is against you. You only reach the land that is totally yours and you can live without any concern is when you get to heaven. Until then, this world is not our home and we have to fight this battle. And so, under the Holy Spirit, Apostle John teaches us to have victory over one of the greatest hostile forces that work against their souls. I can tell you, the demonic world under Satan is much more organized and determined than even the greatest force, military force on earth, which we refer to as the American force. Far better organized and far more effective, fearless. There is only one intent in the heart of the devil, is to attack Christ and his people. All the way they will attack us. The moment you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ until you get to heaven, you will be his target. Where he will corner you and what weapon he use against you, you can never tell. So the Lord wants you not to be afraid, because you are going to feel it. Even though you ignore the fact that you have an enemy or you are in the battlefield, you cannot escape the fact. And you know, nothing is more distressing to you and me than suddenly we wake up realizing that, oh, we are attacked. Just imagine you're all very happily living. Welcome, brother. Just come in. There's space here. can pass through. All the way. You can come and sit. Oh, you want to sit there? All right. And so, you know, nothing distresses us more than suddenly we find ourselves being surrounded, being targeted. Just imagine you are living in such great peace in Singapore. You hardly has any bomb explosion. You hardly have any terrorists trying to bring down the HDB blocks that you are living in. Our MRTs work well. Our SBS buses go smooth. Changi Airport thus far has been saved by God's grace. Of course, there were enemies who have always wanted to bring Singapore down. Even there were people from Indonesia, I hear that, wanted to board the plane and hijack the plane and head straight to Changi and bang in straight into the airport. They can do that anytime. Just imagine one day you wake up hearing this. I think you will be very scared. If you are told that there are 50 terrorists on loose in Singapore with bombs already, anywhere they're going to explode those things, I think we'll be very worried. We are in greater threat than that. Right now the devil is here in this room, here in this forces are here. This world is his territory, not ours. It's almost like you are in Iraq or Syria where ISIS is in charge. And you go there straight into ISIS land and preach the Lord Jesus Christ. You know what happens. And we are not in a better situation. Please don't think that in Singapore we are in a better situation than in Iraq or Syria. Now I know you may think that way because of physical safety, that's all. As far as spiritual safety is concerned, probably we are in a worse situation than there. There Christians stand up for their faith and they are prepared to die. In Iraq and Syria, the genuine Christians would die. They are prepared to die. But here, we are not going to die, so we pretend to be Christians. And we know Christ. We compromise with the devil and we are trapped. We don't even realize we are trapped. Very dangerous situation. Actually, I pray that the Lord will awaken your heart to realize this. So, let's don't think that we are free to walk around as we like. We will be safe. Don't think you can sing any song and watch any movie and listen to any person and go to any place and be in any company with any man and any woman, you'll be safe. No. No. Let me tell you, children who are grown up in Gethsemane, some are going to marry non-Christians. I mean, some may marry Buddhists, some may marry Hindus, some may marry atheists. Some may marry Muslims. It won't be surprising to me anymore. I couldn't just accept the fact for some time, but I realize it's going to happen because some of you are careless. The way you walk, you think you are very smart. You think you are very, very intelligent. You know how to take care of yourself. Now that is foolishness. Because the Bible tells us how to have victory. And when you ignore the path of victory that God gives to us, then what is left is just defeat and devastation. And so let's remember what the Bible says here. There's a hostile world. Remember the beginning of that verse 4. Whosoever born of God overcometh the world. This is a victory that overcometh the world. And then again in verse 5, he that overcometh the world is our enemy, according to this verse. The world is on the side of the devil. not on the side of God. The world is on the side of demonic forces, not on the side of good angels. The world is not on the side of righteousness. The world is on the side of wickedness. The world is not for Christians. The world is our foe. It works against our souls. It is subtle. It influences us with its pleasure and luxury by hiding the fact that they are temporary and cannot be solid foundations of our lives. This epistle has already taught us there is a great hostility between the world and genuine Christians. You remember? Let's remind ourselves by reading some of those verses we studied before in 1 John. Verse 13 of chapter 3. Let's read together. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hates you. So there is hatred. The world hates you. The world hates who?
It's Christians.
That's right. Those who follow Christ. The Christians are hated. Let's don't make it any light. Don't say Singapore loves Christians. No. Don't say America loves Christians. No. No country on earth is a Christian country. Even if in America you see a lot of churches, it's not a world where Christianity is loved. It is hated. In fact, you will be utterly foolish if you believe that this world will love us as Christians. If you think you can bring about God's kingdom through political means and social means, you are wrong, because this world is not for it. Long ago, I thought maybe as a Christian, if I try, you know, as a politician, preach in a righteous and just manner, I realized very quickly, you know, because we are fighting against such wicked forces, if we use weapons of flesh, we will end up violent, and deceptive, and untruthful. Nothing can be far from the truth that this world loves us. 1 John 2, verses 15 to 17, reading it together. 1 John 2, 15 to 17. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world,
the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world.
God and the world are in two opposite directions. Okay, you can read verse 17 as well, I'm sorry. And the world passes away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. God is very clear as to the world's disposition when it comes to spiritual and moral aspirations. The world is wicked. It doesn't love God. So to love God is to hate the world. I hope you get this. The more you love God, the more hatred you feel for the things of this world. And I must also say, the more you love God, the world will hate you too. So there is no league between the world and Christians. There cannot be. Worldliness is against godliness, and love for the world will lead Christians to refrain from loving God. It's very easy to figure out why a young person is not interested in God's ways. Why is he not interested in coming for a wife? Why is he not interested in coming to church for worship? Why is he not interested in praying in the Lord's house? Why is he not even interested to pick up his Bible and read? Answer? Anybody? What's the answer? Why is a man not interested in the things of God? Why? He loves the world. That's why he loves the world. He can deny that, but that he cannot be any other way. Because the world distracts Christians from knowing and doing God's will. It forces Christians to think of temporal and transient things as more desirous and important than heavenly and eternal matters. The world will tell you, girls, beauty and favor are very important. And so you look for acceptance through good-looking appearance, immodest appearance, and so on. But the Bible says, favor is deceitful, beauty is vain, in Proverbs 31. But she that fears the Lord shall be called blessed. And now, so let it be very clear. It's not the power and wealth and strength of this world that make us better Christians, but love for God. Love God. I hope you will be rich toward God. Not rich toward the world, but rich toward God. And that's exactly what's going to make us a very powerful youth group. Rich toward God. Not your wealth, not that you wear expensive clothes or put on fanciful stuff, or you look trendy, or you look more fashionable. No, nothing. It's not how your hair is combed. It's not whether you pierce your nose or your ear, or you've got tattoos. That's the last thing. Whenever I see these things being slowly cherished, slowly. Sometimes you know it's not so good, but you still give way to it, you know. Subtle compromises, subtle. But that's very dangerous. You're just giving one foothold for the devil. You may not be outright going into movie theater and watch all kinds of movies, but then quietly on in your phone or in your computer, you'll spend some time entertaining yourself with the world. You've got to be very careful. I think there is a certain reality about being exposed to the things of this world. For instance, you are in MRT. I understand. I don't take MRT that often, but I understand that nowadays they have advertisements and so on TV screens in MRT and buses, and sometimes they show shows and which are rather immodest and ungodly. And you cannot sit there with your eyes closed all the time. Maybe sometimes you might. And also, even if you close your eyes, your ears are open, and you can hear all the sounds. You go to shopping centers, it will happen. You hear your classmates shouting vulgarities, cursing one another. You can't always run away from those sins. So you will be somehow exposed to these things. But we don't have to cherish them. These things are in the world. If we happen to come across, well, we pray the Lord will deliver us from all these sounds and sights of the world. The Lord will stop them from influencing us. We pray that. But you cannot leave one door open toward this. You cannot leave your windows open toward this. You have to firmly shut it. It's tough, but that's the way it is. In chapter 4, John warned us against the false prophets and the Antichrist that are at work in the world. So not only the world, worldliness, but also there are spiritual forces. Ungodly spiritual forces. They do teach. They do have false religions. And of course, in verses 5 and 6 of 1 John 4, we read, they are of the world, these spirits of Antichrist. They are of the world, therefore they speak of the world, and the world heareth them. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. There's a spirit of truth and a spirit of error. Spirit of error is rebellious, antichrist. There are many antichrists. It constantly confuses us. And they don't stay in the world. The funny thing about them is that they like to infiltrate the church. They will like to infiltrate the people of God and then try to influence them and lead them away. And that's why the Apostle John was saying in 1 John 4, be careful, test every spirit. Remember verse 1? Can you read for me? 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Many false prophets have gone out into the world. So try every spirit. John is not speaking to the worldly people out there. He's talking to the people in the church. You see, the false prophets who have gone out into the world will influence Christians. They will not say, oh, you look Christian, okay, I abandon you. Oh, you wear a cross, okay, I'll stay away. No. I can tell you, when you go out, there may be an unbeliever who come around and say, oh, I love you, or shall we start a business together? Don't worry, I will put in the money. I like you. Oh, then you say, well, I can't do certain things. I'm a Christian, and I cannot have a close relationship with a non-Christian. And then you say, then they say, no worry, I can come with you to church. How about that? I come with you to church. And I can, I heard your pastor is looking for $5 million. I can give $1 million. You bring it. Oh, you get very excited. I tell you, don't bring that $1 million, please. If it will take your soul away. I prefer your soul. And that $1 million, sincerely. And they will tell you, I love you, I will take care of you, I've never seen a person as beautiful as you are. You are the sweetest, cutest thing I ever met. Please come, let's walk. You better know something. That is devil's agent to destroy your soul for the rest of your life. You're gone. And today there is a silly thinking there. There is such a thing called missionary dating. Yeah, I just wrote an article which you can read tomorrow in the bulletin about dating. Dating is a worldly way of finding a life partner. Very dangerous. You go and read. I have more to write. In the coming weeks it will come up one by one. I don't have time to write everything into one article. I may not be so well organized. Because, you know, I'm not writing books and sitting alone doing nothing. Too many things come when I start writing, so the thoughts may be a bit jumpy here and there, but I hope you will read it and understand what is in there. Today, young teens start dating because everybody hates. But they want to probably get married, but they can't get married until they are 25 or 27 or whatever. And they go round and round and round, you know, and whatever happened. Just the other day, I was talking to a young couple. And they are not teens, they are rather close to 30. But they were dating for 2 years, but they are thinking of getting married at the same time. They are quarreling and they decided to break up. How about that? So much for dating. You see, this is not godly way. All this so-called dating is just to quarrel and quarrel and quarrel and quarrel and quarrel and quarrel. And anyhow, okay, I finally fix the date, go get married. And after that, continue to quarrel. It's just rubbish and nonsense. I hope you will have a biblical approach to your attitude. Nothing wrong finding a boyfriend or girlfriend, but there's a time for everything. And also, you must conduct yourself, not like the world, holding hands and walking around like husband and wife. So embarrassing. And then break up. I cannot hold hands. Yeah, hold hands. Then you break up, see what you tell about holding hands. It's so embarrassing. Sit together, lie on the other person's body, hug, kiss, go for holiday together, dating. Why dating? What is dating? Fornication. Lust of the flesh. Dating has another name, flirting. That's what I call it. We all have to be very careful. Many Christians have committed this crime against Christ and His church. And pastors don't preach against this. So many of us who grew up in the church thought it's common, it's okay. It's okay. But I think it's time to speak up. Stop this kind of dating. It's not biblical. You know how many times people go through this dating experiment before they fall, before they really get married? Those who start early in the 50s and, you know, in the teenage years, normally, I think 99% will break up and then try another one. And then walk around, sit together, everybody think they are going steady, they say. Because these two tell one, okay, I won't date anybody else, only you. So we call it going steady. But then soon you see having all the problems. And I want to tell you honestly, I'm not against a young man feeling attracted to a girl or girl feeling attracted, but you better don't behave like the world. We must hold one another in utter purity. You know, God is the one who created Eve for Adam. Adam had no life partner. Adam didn't even realize he needed one. He was just contented with what he, the way God made him. But God said it's not good for Adam to be alone, so God made him a helpmeet. God brought Eve to Adam. And if you have a life partner, he or she will come in God's time. Nobody can steal. So if you happen to be in a relationship, you know, you don't have to follow all over the place. I was a young couple recently. Do you have to send your girlfriend right to the door? Do you have to? I don't think so. It's not your duty. It's her father's duty to look after her. You're not the husband. And you know the way the boys and girls behave is as though they're husband and wife. Then you fall into all sorts of temptation. Must kiss, must hug, must do everything. Otherwise it's not dating. Why? Because the church is attacked by the world and we have come in. After taking advantage of the girl or the boy and engage in such physical closeness, intimacy, when they quarrel, they have no problem to drop one because we are not married. So dating is a phony marriage. Dating is a counterfeit marriage. It demands all the commitment of a marriage and at no strings attached. Do you understand? The man demands the girl will be submissive to him. Why? She is not his wife. Why should she submit? And the girl demands that he must always walk with her, cannot even talk to others. Jealous. Why should the boy be in that situation? He is not her husband. This is phony thing of the world, just to trap Christians in utter peril of fornication. So what happened in the church? I can tell you, no purity in our churches. Even in our churches, I hope
at least this group will be different. Our generation went through horrible experiences in the church. I can see. I just don't want to speak out. I know what happened in the name of dating in Christian churches. Horrible things. And then when they break up, they cannot even look at one another. Then parents get involved. You know, I'm worried. I'm here, Elder Joy is here, Deacon Francis is here, William is here, fathers. Now, you are all our children. If my son goes with his daughter and then do something wrong, how can I look at him? He may be blaming my son, I may be blaming his daughter. And this is why many times in the BB churches, things don't go well. And gossip, bitterness, cannot sit together, cannot serve together. And let nobody say dating is wrong. Nobody says it. I hope we will understand. So start reading the articles I'm going to publish. And I hope you will think carefully. I'm not against one falling in love with another. But there's a time for it when you're ready to get married. All the things that are happening in secondary schools and junior colleges and university are nothing but just fornication, immorality. And we are told that fornication should never be even mentioned once among you, not even once among you. Flee youthful lust, isn't it? So please don't be pressurized to behave like the worldly people. You don't have to dress like them. You know, when a young girl goes out for pakto, you call it, right? Or dating. You immediately know she's going for that because she smelled it friendly. She has put on all the spray to attract the boy. She wears low cut so the man can peep in. She wears shorter clothes. Flesh is totally exposed. Dating. What good can come out of it but some sort of sexual immorality and nothing much? And this cannot be in our churches today. Cannot be. We are God's people. If you keep on watching the movie and entertainment world, you will behave like that, and the kind of people you will have are those which the entertainment world will promote. The teenage sensations. Listen to God's word, not to the world. If you listen to the world, you will fall into the influence of the spirit of error. That's why the Bible says, we are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby we know the spirit of truth and spirit of error. If anybody wants to live like the world, we know they are being influenced by the spirit of error. Let's read verse 19 of 1 John 5, chapter 5, verse 19. And we know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness. There is not a corner, there is not even an inch square meter on this earth that can be called righteous. The whole world lieth in wickedness. And that's why, my brothers and sisters, when you engage in your studies, your activities in this world, be ever vigilant. You are not safe anywhere. It's like landmines everywhere. You put your feet here, you think you are standing in the safe ground. No. If you press hard, it will explode under your feet. The whole world lieth in wickedness. It's almost, to transfer that into military terms, every inch, every millimeter on this earth is planted with spiritual bombs, spiritual mines. Unless you know this, you will not be vigilant. So the first thing is that to understand we are in enemy's territory. There's nothing we can easily accept as helpful. Victory comes to the one who understands there's an enemy and how enemy works. If you don't know how enemy works, you will be easily trapped. So know these things that the Bible says. We live in a hostile world. And so be vigilant. But we thank God. These things are told, not that we may be frightened and abandon our battle, but that we may be more vigilant and diligent to fight the battle. Okay, the second thing that we want to take note is that we are called to be conquerors of the world, born to be conquerors. You are not born again to be losers, but you are born again to be conquerors. Praise the Lord, right? I think that makes me very happy. Really happy. Whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. Just imagine, God has redeemed you and made you a child of God, that in this world you may rejoice in great victories. When a sinner is born into the kingdom of God by the word of God and the Spirit, his allegiance automatically changes. And that's where it all begins. Because you align yourself with God, whom the devil cannot defeat. You immediately become on the Lord's side. So we have that beautiful hymn, right? Who is on the Lord's side? Yes, if you're on the Lord's side, victory is yours. And that's what happens when we are born again. From the power of darkness and the influence of the world and dominion of the devil, we are now transferred into the kingdom of the great God. So you are no more a soldier of the world. You are no more a servant of the world, but you are in the kingdom of God, fighting for Christ. But let's not forget, the war is on. Okay, now the war is real. When you were on the side of the devil, there was no war. But now you are on the Lord's side, the war becomes intense. You are now going to be the target every day. But that's okay. That's okay because you are safe if you stay with the Lord. Let's remember what Jesus said in John's Gospel, chapter 15, verses 18 and 19. I've printed it out in your notes. Let's read that together. John 15, verses 18 and 19. If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. See, because the Lord chosen you out of the world hates you. And now you are on the side of the Lord. The Lord was hated by the world, and God chose you out of the world, and so the devil is very unhappy that Jesus has taken you. Thank God he called you. He is the one who loves you. You didn't love him first, he loved you first. And he lovingly enlisted you in his army. Again in John's Gospel we read, chapter 7, verse 7, Jesus saying, the world cannot hate you, but me it hateth, because I testified that the works thereof are evil. The reason why we see such great hatred of the world to Christ is because Jesus exposes the real wicked nature of the world. Jesus says the world is evil. Jesus is constantly exposing. And we ourselves don't like when somebody tried to peep into our life, right? To expose. Do you like someone looking into your SMS? You will try to protect. If everything is clean and neat, seldom we have a problem. Of course, I know if you are a counselor and somebody confides things with you through a text, and you don't want others to read it for the safety of the counselee. But young people like you don't have such secrets. Seldom, very seldom. But I've never seen young people being so secretive in all my life than this generation. Very secretive. We never had text messages when we grew up. If there is a phone, it's in the living room. Whenever we talk, everybody can hear. And then, of course, after a while, they had this electronic phones that you can take and go into your room. And even in my house, we can never have such a phone. Now, they had TVs. When I grew up, I didn't have a TV in my house. Only recently my father and mother had a TV, but whenever I want to watch some World Cup soccer or cricket, I have to go to my relative's house to see, because my father says no. All right. But now, you all have TVs in the living room, but you also have TVs in your room. Now you have it in your pocket. With YouTube and Vimeo and whatever. Any wicked thing you can watch. Any wicked thing, anytime, at your will. You take this into the toilet and sit there for 2 hours and watch or so. More privacy. What are you doing? I'm using toilet. Really? Yeah. Now nobody can hear what you're hearing because you have things to plug in. The world has taken over the lives of our youths. It's like the American stealth planes, you know. They cannot be detected by radar. Only when the bomb explodes, you realize you are gone. So today the devil has moved in with this stealthy behavior. You won't know whether you're watching bad things or listening to bad, because everything is put straight into your eye, straight into your ears, and straight into your soul. Only when your life is messed up, then everybody, what happened to my son? What happened to my daughter? Too late. Last time at least we could figure out, oh, the phone comes. And the father picks up. Yes? Can I talk to Dorcas? Oh, who is that? A friend of his. All right. Dorcas? There's a call. It's a Dorcas thing. And after 2 hours, a call comes. Hello? Who is that? Can I speak to Dorcas? Okay, same guy. Same guy. Okay. Dorcas, you got a call. Next morning, again a call. Same guy. Now, Dorcas, who is that? Now, father doesn't know. Nobody knows. It's all communicated straight. And everything is done, then we will. You see how dangerous things have become? Parents cannot protect the kids anymore. Gone are the days. Gone are the days. We have absolutely no control over you. None of us. We are just worried. You know, if Christian parents have ever been so worried in their life, it's this generation of parents. Me, Elder Choi, Deacon Francis. We are the worst. If you become parents, next time you understand, you will say the same thing. We are the worst kind of parents ever lived, because we have the greatest of fears. I don't know what the world is going to invent to put evil right in your pocket. Next time you probably don't even need a phone. Maybe hologram, I don't know what they will come up with. And I just pray with earnestness that you take this message very seriously. All these equipments have good purpose and it can be used for better things, but the world will not let you use it only for good things. They will take you out. So remember this the Lord constantly exposes the evil of these things. And so people don't like it. If you have a hatred for Christ, if you have a hatred for the preacher who tells the truth, if you have a hatred for the Word of God and Bible study like it, and you are not interested to go, I know what they're going to say, I don't want, because if I go there, I feel very guilty. If I go there, every time people will be criticizing me because I dress like that, I walk like that, I have that kind of friend, I don't want to go to church, then I tell you, you are already evil. That's why you are like that. You're not at all comfortable because you are not in league with God and His righteousness. You know, you are then in great danger. I want you to take note of it. You are in extreme danger when you come to that level. I also want to tell you something. If you are a Christian and the world will laugh at you and the world will say, how come you are like this? And they try to add pressure on you, they make fun of you, don't feel bad, okay? Because then you know you are safe. Because you are not of the world, you are born of God, and that's why you are different. So you won't be looking like them, you won't be talking like them, you won't be going where they go, you won't be participating in what they do. And they may make fun of it because you are different. They may think of you as weird. They may cut loose every kind of friendship and association with you. But that's fine. Because we are born of God. How wonderful is that? Our spiritual birth is a great declaration, a great announcement that we are chosen to be victors. Wow. So you who believe in the Lord Jesus, and I want to believe all of you are genuine believers. And I want to tell you, my dear brothers and sisters, you are called to be victors. And that's why our youth fellowship is a wonderful time. We want to talk to you not as losers, we want to talk to you as victors. We want to talk to you not as those who are destined to lose, but destined to win. And so when you go to schools, when you go to universities, when you go out into the world, we send you to fight and win. Because that's why Jesus saved us. And so we warn you, and when you come together, we brief you about the possibility of devil's attack. We warn you, we brief you, I don't know what more. Maybe we even give you the resources you need so you can go out and fight a good fight. And so I hope you will stand up today after this Bible study and dedicate yourself to God and say, Lord, I thank you for saving me. I'm on your side, not for the world. And I will go and fight a good fight of faith. Nothing short of that. Whatever the world may throw at you, it cannot prevail against you. The fiery darts of the devil are not meant to destroy you because God has given you the shield of faith and the breastplate of righteousness. You remember that? And you have given the helmet of salvation. And God has not only called you and even equipped you to be a fighter and given you the word, even the sword of the Spirit. So let's read Romans 8, which further establishes this great truth that we are born to be victors. Let us read Romans 8, 35 to 37 on page 141 of your notes. Reading together.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword?
As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. We are conquerors, more than conquerors. It means we are super conquerors, hyper conquerors. In fact, the Greek word for more than conquerors is one word. It starts with uper,
which we translate as hyper. We are hyper conquerors. More than conquerors. In all these things, people may do the worst thing they can ever imagine. May make you naked and stand somewhere, make you naked in public to make fun of you. Because you are modest. They wear bikini and walk around, but you are modest. To embarrass you, they may rag you, you know, there's a thing called ragging. Maybe it's not so common nowadays. In my time, when we go to universities, people will purposely rag you. They do many things. You know, when we dress up well and we come to school, a group of guys will be upstairs with a bucket of water. And when you walk through the ground, when you come near, they will pour one bucket of water on you. And you'll be all drenched in water and you go to class all wet and everybody laugh at you. Sometimes they will put a firecracker under your chair where you are sitting. And you sit on it, boom, it explodes and everybody laughs. All kinds of funny things they do. Actually, it was very bad in the hostel where we live. They will make you naked and ask you to walk along the corridor. A very wicked thing. And if you don't do it, they will whack you. They will literally punch you. Wicked things they used to do. But now they are controlling it in many universities, in many parts of the world. I don't know whether you have such a thing today in Singapore University. Do you have ragging? No, right? No, I hardly hear that.
They
stopped now. There was something like that here. Yeah.
It's
a now a serious offense, yeah. In those days, they used to do. But we don't know what the world can do. I mean, they've done that to Christ. They rip him off and just only the undergarments. Then they beat him up and they, you know, cast lot for his outer garments. You remember that? That's the way they humiliated our Lord Jesus. So Paul says in ancient time, such humiliating things have been done. And even ISIS do that. They rape the poor girls. And so if some wicked fellows come over and take over our country and challenge us to give up our faith, you may be raped, you may be molested. And your father cannot do anything because his both hands are tied. Your brothers cannot do anything. And you may be raped right in front of their eyes. And the only chance they give you is that you give up and embrace their religion or embrace their ways of life. If you don't do it, they may just kill you. But we are not going to lose it because these things are nothing for us. If we lose our physical safety, let it be, but we belong to Christ. You know, just because they rape us, we will not become enemies of God. Enemies of God. We won't. God will not throw us out because we have been abused. He will love us even more. God has His way of looking after us. You know, you better learn something about life. Stop loving yourself and loving your body more than Christ. And for us, in all these things, we are more than conquerors. Your souls cannot be suppressed. I can tell you this. Christians are a bunch of people whose heart can never be crushed. Their spirit can never be quenched. The worst treatment can only embolden them. Can only make them victors. So we are not talking about running away and escape from tribulations and temptations. We face them head on. That's why we are victors. We don't commit suicide because there are troubles. Because there are problems. You don't kill ourselves. You face it. If you were to ask a man who is the greatest conqueror in the world, he might say Alexander the Great. But was he a real conqueror? Was he a real conqueror of the world? My answer would be no. He was himself the vanquished man. He was defeated. I mean, the death killed him at a very young age. He was not very old to die. I think 30 he died. if my memory is correct.
Not because he was defeated in a war, but he became sick. He fought for the world and he won it. But mark it, my friends, how it mastered its master, conquered its conqueror, and lashed the monarch who had been its scourge. Alexander was the greatest slave of it. Alexander loved the world. He thought he's conquering the world, but world conquered him. He went after the world. He killed millions because the world conquered his heart. Not because he conquered the world. We are conquerors of the world. You don't live for the world. If you live for the world, then you are a slave of the world, and the world is your master. And you lose everything. It is said of Alexander the Great, just before he died, he gave command to his generals that when they take him to bury, they're going to put his both hands out, stretched out, open, not clenched, but open, to tell everybody, I came with nothing, I go having nothing in my hands. Came empty-handed and leave empty-handed. What can you conquer in this world? Absolutely. Even a conqueror like Alexander the Great will be buried in a 6-foot grave. And death tells us we are all the same, no difference. Nobody conquers this world, but the world conquers you. So, my dear friends, the only one who has the hope of eternity that looks down on this world. Oh, what's the glory of this world? It passeth away. I don't love the world. And you know who they are? Those who follow Christ. They are the conquerors of the world. So if you are so full of, you know, attraction for this world, and you rejoice in the things you possess in this world, then I tell you, you are conquered by the world. You are not a conqueror. You cannot cut loose your soul from its grip. You are stuck inside. And so ask yourself, what are you striving for in this world? Let it be for Christ and Christ alone. All the rest will reduce you to nothing, a miserable loser at the end. So we ask, how to overcome the world? It's not by escaping to some corners of the world where there are no apparent temptations, but by taking on the world, by trusting in God, in places that God has appointed us to live victoriously. So let's take on the world. Singapore is our territory, which God allocated. Not that here there will be a peaceful empire for Christ's righteousness. This is a tough corner of the world. Some others are called in the land of the ISIS, some are called in Pakistan, some are called in China under communism, some are called in the free world, so-called free world of Europe. But no way is Christians free to roam around as they like. The world will come to destroy them. So in this country, in this place, in this generation, you have an appointment from God. And He called you, He saved you, He sanctified you, He equipped you with all the armor of God that you may fight and win. And you better don't die losing your soul. You better live and die as a victor, okay? Okay, now the Lord also tells us in this passage how to have that victory. By faith. By faith we overcome. What does it say? And this is a victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. This is the victory. You are not required of anything else but faith to have victory. Faith is a big topic. Last church camp was on faith. But I think I need 2 more camps to talk about faith. Even this morning in our home, when we had our devotion, Jesus asked the disciples at the end of his upper room conversation, Do you really believe?
It's a shocking thing. After 3 years of training, nurturing, all that, Jesus asked them the question. Because the faith is under attack. Jesus said after asking that question, soon the shepherd will be slaughtered and the sheep will scatter. That means the disciples will run away and Peter will deny the Lord Jesus. So Jesus asked, what kind of faith do you have? Is your faith strong enough? But again, we know one thing about faith is that it doesn't stand in our strength, it stands in God's strength. We believe because God gives us grace to believe. Peter continued to believe not because he had the power. He failed, but Jesus after resurrection came and looked for him and restored him. He didn't let Peter's faith utterly die. So some of us are actually under attack and our faith is rather wavering. Just look to God. He is speaking to you today. He's telling you, I want to fan and set aflame your faith again. And so the word of God and the Spirit is working in your heart today. To lift you up from where you have fallen. To lift you up from your miserable condition where you behave without faith in the Lord Jesus. So he says to you, you want victory? Or you can. And you must overcome the world to have that victory. And the way to have that overcoming power, that zeal, that seals your victory is faith. Faith is the victory. Right? Remember the song? Yes. Because the forefathers of our faith have understood that. Faith is victory. Whether it's Martin Luther or John Calvin or great missionaries who went to worlds so dark and deserted and preached the gospel and win tribes for Christ. It's not because they wandered the world, but they believed in the supremacy of Christ and the greatness of the kingdom that is to come. Their heart was lost because they believed everything God's word revealed. They took the kingdom of God by faith. So they conquered the unconquerable in this world. And to this God has called all of you. Not to live some meager life of, you know, ups and downs, but constantly riding high as victors. So you pray better. Lord, increase my faith. Strengthen my faith. I cannot live like this as a Christian. This is pathetic, constantly weighed down by the attack of the devil. I think I'm somebody and yet I know I'm nothing. What do I gain? You sang well, but that doesn't make you a Christian. Anybody can sing. Now just because you sing four parts in Gethsemane Youth Choir, you're not going to get into heaven. Don't think you're an angel. A lot of nice choirs in this world do not enter the heaven, right? You just have to turn on YouTube, you can hear all the beautiful voices of people singing fantastic choir. Deep voice, high voice, soprano voice, all kinds of voices. Wow, mesmerizes. But that doesn't mean they are spiritual. That doesn't mean they have faith. The thing that pleases God the most is faith. Anything you do without faith is sin. Anything you do without faith is sin. Do you sing just to show off that you can sing well? Then that singing is deleted. It's of no use. You sing because you believe on the Lord. You can sing in choir. You can sing in different parts, but out of faith. Not for your glory. Some people sing so they can feel good that they achieve something. Some people sing because they want to impress somebody else who stand next to them. They sing because they, you know, enjoy singing. Some sort of personal pleasure. If that's the reason why you come to church,
why you have friends in the church. If that's the reason you do something in the church, then that's not victory, my friend. That's further locking up of your soul in sin, pride, and self by the world. Faith! The scripture says faith. Faith is a victory. Who do you believe and what do you believe? How much do you believe? How clear is your faith? How strong is your faith? Where is your faith? Do you have it? How much of it? Is it growing? Is it flourishing? Is it like the tree by the river, bearing its fruit in due season? What sort of faith do you have? We all believe in the Lord Jesus if we are believers. As John 1:12 tells us, as many as received Him, to them gave He power to become sons of God. Great power to be sons of God when you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and in His name. The power to become the sons of God. No man has the power to have this right. It is divine power. It is a divine authority. And so when you exercise your faith in Jesus Christ, you are endued with divine power, even divine authority. You always stand in the authority of God. As a Christian, when you refuse to lie, you have the authority of God with you. When you refuse to be like the rest of the world, when you refuse to clothe like others, when you refuse to sing the songs of others, you have divine authority. You may not have the worldly fascination and glamour and acceptance. That's okay. Count it nothing but dung. But you have the power of God. Let not the care of life and desire for better things cause you to yield to the world. Let us believe that our Father would care for us. Well, He's a good Father. Don't lose your life. If God is stirring your heart to be a missionary, please pursue it to the end. Your parents might say, are you sure? Who will take care of you? What will become of you? Are you sure you will live or not? Don't be stupid. You may not be able to even preach the gospel. Before that, they may kill you. Don't worry. Maybe your duty is only to open the door and then die and go to heaven and somebody else follow that path later. But you need to have faith to do those things. You've got to believe that God has promised to look after you. And my duty is to seek the kingdom of God first and His righteousness. All these things shall be added unto you. That's the kind of faith you want to have if you want to overcome the doubt and the fear and the problems of this world. May God encourage you. You know, go read great men of faith in the Bible. Read the stories, how by faith they had victories, whether it's, you know, people like Noah or Abraham or David or Daniel or New Testament saints of God like Peter or Paul or Thomas or whoever it be, or even biographies of Christians. Martin Luther or John Calvin or John Wycliffe or William Tyndale or all those great names. You know, the Bible you have in your hands, so well published people had to give their life to translate this. If there's a new one Bible for which the translators died, it's William Tyndale's Bible and King James Bible. People who tried to translate this and make it, you know, spread, died. Now you will carry around without any trouble. It is that kind of faith that precedes us and that helps us to stand in our faith. And so if you don't stand up in faith, the next generation will have nobody. Faith of our fathers living still. Because they fought a good fight and they refused to surrender to the temptations and trials of the world. that they were big. They were bigger than world. They were bigger than life. They were bigger than death. Even death could not stop them from achieving the glory of God in this world. And my dear friends, young friends, you are called for greater things than the world promised you. You are called to be Christians, to stand in glory with Christ. I pray that your hearts will see, your eyes will perceive, and love to cherish those things that only God can give. And that's faith. Faith means forsaking all, I take Him. F-A-I-T-H. Forsaking all, I take Him. God is the single focus, single passion, single ultimate goal I have, to which I shall give myself. Such would have great victory. We also want you to know, this victory is sure, because the commander, the Lord, is with you. Verse 5, who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? Your faith is in Jesus. The Son of God is a conqueror. Our faith has an object, and that's Jesus Christ. We are not aimless. We are not clueless. We are not confused. Our perspective is clear. Our heart is settled in Christ. Everyone who fully trusts the Lord Jesus and follows His command shall surely enjoy victory. Jesus is the commander of our souls. He is the author and finisher of our faith. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? Do you? Good. Then stay with me. He is a victorious King. He took on the adversary in the wilderness. For 40 days he fasted and prayed. The devil came, but he defeated him. In the Garden of Gethsemane, the Lord had victory. On the cross, he had victory. On the third day after his death, he defeated and came out with great majesty of God. Death and sin and devil all were vanquished. Christ victorious. He is our great leader. To follow him is to go to victory. To follow him is to taste the joy of victory. He cannot fail. He will not fail. I must trust him. He will not fail. He cannot fail. I must trust him. So what do you pray? Lead on, O King Eternal. I will follow you. And I want to have that faith that will give me the great victory in this world. So my dear friends, all that we say to you is that don't love the world. We are here to fight the world. Christian youths are to fight the world. Don't bring in the world into the church. Don't bring in the world into your home. Don't let the world creep in some subtle form into your soul. Because the world will subdue. A lot of things you can do for Christ cannot be done because the world blinds you, it deafens you, it distracts you. So keep the world out. Keep Christ as the joy of your faith, your heart. You will see achieving great victories even before you realize. You know, there are some great people in Christian history who died young. And one of them was the Scottish pastor. I always miss his name. I know it and I don't know it. Can somebody help me? McShane, that's right. McShane. You must go and read his story. He died at the age of 30. Started preaching from 18, at the age of 18. great preacher. Thousands were saved. He ministered in a city called Dundee in Scotland. Dundee was just a small village. In this town, it became an industrial city. And he was there to preach. Thousands turned to Christ. Only 30, but he achieved great things for the Lord. Charles Spurgeon didn't live very long. By 55, he died. But he was a great preacher, wasn't he? You read Jim Elliot's story, who went to one of the South American countries to preach the gospel. He was a young man. He got married, but they didn't live long to have children. Husband went to meet with a group of tribal people, leaving the wife at the base camp. He went up, but he was killed. He didn't come back. But through Jim Elliot and his five friends, the Lord opened that place to the gospel. And many things have been achieved in this world because young men with undaunting faith set out to glorify their Savior. Will we have that privilege? We should. And you are the one for that. The Lord save you for that. So seek Him. He will show you great and mighty things which you have not known. Call unto me, I will answer you, and show thee great and mighty things. That's the promise. You believe? We are called to be victors, overcomers. Three times we are told in today's passage, overcome the world. We who are born again, overcome the world. We don't need anything else. We have everything we need in Christ. Ready? I hope you're happy to know this. Let's pray.
Almighty God, our Father in heaven, we thank Thee once again that we have visited, heard of Your word, hear of Your word again. Teach us not to love things of this world, but to love the Lord Jesus more and more. Pray that God will make us overcomers of this world. We know that in this world there are lots of temptation, at times where we have sinned, we should have sinned against Thee. Forgive us of all our sins, cleanse us and make us anew, that we may be victors for Christ. We thank Thee for the gathering of all the youth. Pray that Thou will continually strengthen our faith, that we may draw closer and closer to Thee. In Jesus' blessed name we pray.
Amen.